Well, good morning again. I have the distinct pleasure of introducing three of the top minds in our sport with respect to the development and use of technology in rowing. In the interest of time, I'm going to introduce all three speakers up front, and also a reminder that all three speakers will be available at lunch, along with our other presenters on technology, be available at lunch and during the afternoon break to demonstrate their technologies and to answer any questions you may have. They'll be located either in the foyer outside the room here or inside the room this side over here. Our first speaker will be Dr. Valery Kleshnev. Valery has been involved in rowing for a long time, first as a rower in the USSR, then a coach, and finally a biomechanist in both Australia and England. In 2009, Valery founded BioRow, focusing on R&D in rowing biomechanics. Valery currently works with his BioRow system with many teams and athletes around the world. He also publishes a monthly newsletter, biomechanics newsletter, which I'm sure many of us in the room read regularly. Our second speaker is Milan Bashanovic from Austria. He's a trainer, a national coach, and a former professor at the Viennese School of Sport. For 22 years, Milan has run Webesport, a company that provides training technology for a number of sports. He is also a founder of a well-known technology that many of us use called Watt Bikes. Our final speaker this morning will be Michael Naughton from Nielsen Kellerman. Michael rode at both the high school and university level and holds a degree in naval architecture and ocean engineering. Since Michael started at NK in 1995, he's had many jobs including assembler, sales associate, and is currently the director of product management for Nielsen Kellerman. As we know, Nielsen Kellerman products are used by many of us around the world. So if you don't mind, please welcome Valery Kleshnev.
Thanks, Peter, for a nice introduction. Good morning, everyone. So, first of all, very briefly, I put together some common things like our vision and mission, and it's a bit funny, it's a bit of smile, but finally, if I try to find the essence, what actually I'm doing, I try to find something new, to create something new, and I put it in these words, to continue the process of creation of this world, which started by, you know who, someone else, by means of discovering a new phenomena and inventing new things. That's what I like to do. That's my vision. And in particular, I try to apply it in such a small things as a rowing, because we can compare with other things, not so many rowers, like even if you compare with other sports like cycling, swimming, athletics, I think we are a little bit smaller. But anyway, what I try to do is to help rowing people who is curious enough, open-minded enough, that's keyword, open-mindedness, to improve rowing technique and row smarter and faster. And it works. By means of essential measurements, objective analysis, and practical feedback. So nothing personal, just data, analysis, information, and some conclusions. The main areas, what we do is four main areas. First is consultancy. We can put equipment on your boats, measure your athletes, rowers, and provide some feedback. Then also we produce some equipment from very simple to more complicated, which helps you to row faster and better. And then we consult bigger companies. We have experience working with such a well-known companies as a Concept, Nissan, Kellerman, Vintec, RP3, and some other smaller companies like Active Tools, British company. Fourth area is studies and publications. That's the most interesting, but never have time to do it enough in this area, but still we have some experience here. Now let's talk about the subject, Roving Biomechanics and Technology, because the topic was technology originally, not really biomechanics, and I put here first just a list of the first studies, first publications on the measurements in roving. You see it's quite long history, more than 100 years. The first measurements were done in actually end of 19th century. And my question is, roving science always makes positive effect, really? Of course it should. But we know, and from my experience, from your experience, we know it's not always working this way. So here I put the most common, what we call roving myth, and I think they created, science contributed a lot into creation of these myths. First of all, variation of the boat speed, boat velocity is the main reason of the energy losses. When the people make some equipments, they start measuring boat velocity, and they well-known fact that drag resistance proportional to the square of the boat velocity, and the power energy losses are proportional to the cube of the boat velocity. So when the boat velocity fluctuates, not constant, you lose more energy than if the boat velocity is constant. Then, but in fact, when this is simply the wrong modeling. The people who put in forward that boat velocity variation, they didn't account to other factors like inertia losses and other things. So in fact, only about 1% of total energy lost because of variation of the boat speed. Then blade efficiency, another myth about blade efficiency. When I was a rower, coach told me, don't push too hard at catch, because you push, actually you squeeze the riggers inwards and you push the blade outwards the water. And thanks to Falk and Nolte and other scientists, hydrolift effect was discovered, and it was found that at sharp angle of attack, the blade works as a hydrofoil. And similar effect can be found in other sports, for example, in swimming, they move their hand not straight, but at some angle. And very simple example, the birds move the wings vertically, but they fly forward, right? And this myth about the stretcher force, which is negative, comes from this variation of the board speed. So the all the things about board check, don't push the stretcher before you pull the handle. But in fact, stretcher force is compulsory to create the blade propulsive force, because this is a pair of forces, stretcher connected to the pin. And 40% of the power transferred through the stretcher in rowing. This is the main variables which we can measure in rowing, and they can be divided in three categories. Kinematics, which is velocities and accelerations, velocity, boat velocity, acceleration, seat, trunk, also angles, vertical and horizontal. Kinetics is the forces, usually handle force, gate force, stretcher force, And also we can measure some environmental variables like wind speed and direction, water temperature, etc. And when we measure things, it's important, my point is always important to understand how your measurement, here is measurements at the bottom level of this flow chart of rowing biomechanics. So it's important to understand what we need to measure in rowing and how to measure it. And I put it in three levels, this chart. Measurement level, what we measure, then analysis, and on top performance level, basically this is your gold medal, your result. It depends not only by mechanics, but technique, it's only part of the performance. Also physiology is very important, even probably more important. Psychology, race strategy and all that, lifestyle, administration, motivation, etc. But when we talk about biomechanics, the two main areas of analysis at analysis level is efficiency, which is simply a ratio of the energy on input and output, and effectiveness, ability to utilize power, is closely related to rowing power, but also providing high efficiency. At the bottom of the analysis level, we have rowing power, which is, of course, the most important variable, and not only in rowing, other sports as well. Force curve gives you dynamics of the movement of the system, and it's related, we can actually measure it directly, the force curve, and measuring oar angle and handle force or gate force, we get these two areas. Then, for rowing style, we need to measure something more, like movement of the body segments from video or using sensors in the board, seat position and shoulders position. Board efficiency defined by board velocity and acceleration, also pitch, yaw, and other rotations of the board. And a blade efficiency also important, and we can measure it when we measure vertical angle of the oar. So this is quite simplified picture. This is a little bit more complicated. This is about rowing efficiency, and basically there are three main parts of rowing efficiency. First, we call it internal or muscle or metabolic efficiency, and this is the ratio of two powers. We have handle power, or let's call it mechanical power, because in fact the rower produces power through the stretcher as well. And this is divided by metabolic power consumed by the rower, and it ranges about 24% on average, this efficiency. Then the second one is blade propulsive efficiency, ratio of propulsive power to the handle power, which provided by on the previous stage by the rower. And some part of the energy goes into the slippage of the blade, right? And then this is what we call board velocity efficiency. This is exactly what was emphasized in that all the models. Variation depend on the variation of the board speed. In fact, there is another component, inertial losses. Basically, they are part of this internal muscle efficiency, because to produce that mechanical power in rowing, the rower need to move actually two masses, his mass relative to the board mass, or in fact, other way around. Board is lightest, board moves more displacement of the board, about five times more than displacement of the center of mass of the athlete. So here, if you sum up all energy losses from metabolic power, maximal on input to the minimal required power, providing the board speed is constant, and split it in this diagram, we can see that about 91% of the losses explained by actually rowers mechanics, biomechanics of the rower. This is an efficiency of the muscles. They produce more heat than mechanical energy. But it also coordination of the muscles, because when you use them incorrectly, you can, for example, activate muscles antagonist altogether, and they one muscle work against another one. Or very common mistake, bump shooting, when the legs is going too fast. So in fact, the trunk consumes the power produced by legs, and this is an efficiency as well. So it all included in this 91%. 2.4% is inertial losses. As I said, we need to move the two masses, but we can't do much. If your row is no slide, shorter stroke, we will lose anyway. We can't use bigger muscles of the legs. And then about 5.3% is blade efficiency losses. We can improve it a little bit if we improve the blade work. And then only, as I said, about 1.3% variation of the board speed. So this is general model of rowing efficiency. Oops. Now, we agree that power is basically the most important variable in rowing. So how can we measure definitions of rowing power. How can we measure rowing power in real life? So this is the first method, is traditional method. We call it handle power. Basically, we assume that the fulcrum or center of rotation is a pin. And power is actually a product of two velocities, handle force and handle velocities here, right? And it's similar if we introduce the actual inboard leverage. It's actually a product of the torque to angular velocity. And it's easy to measure. And this is traditional method. But in fact, in rowing, as I said, the rower apply power not only to the handle, because the stretcher moves. The board is not stationary, like on concept erg, it doesn't happen on stationary erg. The stretcher is fixed, velocity is zero, so only handle power applied to the stationary erg. In rowing, about 40% of the power transferred through the stretcher, about 60% through the handle. So that if you assume that the center of rotation, fulcrum, is the center of mass of the rower, and we have these two components, so basically the total power is sum of these two stretcher and the handle power. In fact, that rowing power very closely correlated with the traditional method, with the handle power. Its only difference is inertia of the board, because in this way we do not measure inertia of the board. In this way, if we sum up these two powers, it includes both inertia But in fact, it's more difficult to measure, because where is the center of the mass of the rover, we don't really know. It changes when the rover changes the moves during the drive and changes the posture and position of his segments. And another, the third method is the most complex. It considers the whole rover board system as a whole. And if you look from the top on this system, the rover is here, this is a board, or, and the fulcrum, in fact, real fulcrum in the world reference system, world coordinates, somewhere at the ore shaft close to the blade. This is a stationary point, and the whole system moves around this point. And in fact, it's more complicated. This point, position of this point changes during the drive. And at catch, it's closer to the tip, and then it moves inwards, and then outwards again. It depends on the slippage of the blade and the velocity of the board. And the most complicated method, but it's absolutely impractical, because to define velocity of the center of mass of the system is very difficult. Then we need to measure, we need to find where this real fulcrum, we need to measure board speed and or angle. Then we need to measure propulsive force, which is basically difference between pin force forward and the stretcher force. So this is very complicated method, but I'm sure the reason I'm showing it here is to relate to the measurement methods, because people believed that this pin propulsive force is the most important. In fact, it's not. And when we're talking about power, this is handle force is most informative. When we measure this pin force, we have to measure all other things to define rowing power properly. And now we come into measurement methods and devices. And again, it's possible to measure force and power at three points. As I said, handle force and power, then this is the most accurate measurements. We put some sensors. This is our BioRow sensor. This is actually German sensors. They work in a similar way. They actually measure torque bent of the oar, and automatically no error on where the rover actually apply the force. You know, in rowing, especially in sweep rowing, the rovers pull more outside arm at catch, inwards, inside arm at the finish. So this point of the force application at the handle is floating during the, may float during the drive. But when we measure in this way, bent of the oar, torque, it doesn't matter. It's automatically compensated. So this is the most accurate methods. Then when we measure gate force in perpendicular direction to the oar shaft, this is our new Nissen-Kellerman Empower oar lock. I know Weber system have RoweX. Weber have RoweX system similar, measure similar way. So in this way, my estimation of power measurements could be plus minus 5%, depending on because we need to know this real inboard, and if rover pull a little bit more, especially in sweep rowing, more inside outside arm, it could vary. And when we measure pin force, in fact, anyway, we have to derive the handle force somehow using trigonometry, also using inboard. But here, the axial force could be measured with the pin force as well, especially at long angles at the catch. So the error from our experiments could be up to 20, plus minus 20% in different rows. Now a little bit classification of the sport technology, just to make you the whole picture, and just to give you my vision and experience on this, all these measurements and technology. So I would classify all that systems and devices in two, three main dimensions. First of all, I would say practicality here. That means how obtrusive or transparent the measurements. Then complexity, basically this is number of variables we measure. We can measure one or two variables, or we can measure 10 or 20. And basically they are related, two related areas. Usually the higher complexity, the less practicality. It's more obtrusive, takes more time from rovers, and actually makes measurements more difficult. And then technology level, what sort of technology we use. It could be very simple sensors like angle sensors or position sensors, but it could be very complicated systems like video analysis and current technologies growing very fast. And in this coordinate system, I would put three main application areas in terms of these factors. First of all, monitoring must be very unobtrusive, very easy to use for athletes and coaches, less complex, and level of technology may vary. It all depends how much money basically you have, because the higher technology, the more cost of device you use or the system you use. Then screening, somewhere in the middle, average complexity and practicality. And some research studies could be very complex, very unpractical, very obtrusive, and also they can use different level of technology. And here is just my guess, my estimation of the current system which we can use in these three factors, practicality, complexity, and technology. I think the level of technology is very similar. I think NK Empower or Lock is very practical, very easy to use. Complexity is not very high, and compared to our system, it's other way around. Practicality is not so good, complexity is higher. And video analysis, I think it may be very different. You can just shoot video and watch it, very simple. But also you can use very sophisticated technologies like markers tracking, 3D video analysis, using drones and all sorts of things with video analysis. So it's just examples, nothing. I may be wrong, I don't know. Then another classification of technology is what methods we use. I think it could be direct measurements, which is very simple interpretation, very reliable. For example, in our system we measure directly movement of the trunk and the seat, but it's obtrusive because you have to connect something to the body of the rower. Indirect measurements is less obtrusive, could be less obtrusive, say We can put accelerometer here, but interpretation would be very difficult because you have to put a lot of resources and time to make the something right from that measurements. And then another factor is contact or non-contact methods. Non-contact is very simple example is video. Also we may use ultrasound sensors, radar guns to measure speed. Contact methods, we put some sensors on. And usually we measure kinematics, angles, positions, velocities using non-contact methods. And kinetics, force, and power is better to measure with some sensors. Important thing is feedback factor. How to make it more effective. I also put two main concepts here. Understanding of what for the rower, how rower athlete understands what he is doing, and also correction, how effectively the athlete can correct his movement pattern or her movement pattern. And there's three sorts of feedback: immediate, within seconds when the rower sees some feedback in real time, and in this way the correction the most effective. Straight away the rower can change next stroke, they can change the movement pattern. Then post-exercise feedback, not oftenly used in rowing, but in other sports like in diving, gymnastics, athletics, they jump from the in the water, then they watch video, or in throwing, or in athletics and other jump in athletics jumping, they also can see after every trial they can see the result, what they actually doing. And the most traditional is after session feedback. After session, delay time usually 1 hour to days, could be weeks and months. And when we're talking about measurements and analysis, so it's better for understanding, so the coach or technical person have a chance to analyze what actually happened during session, but ability connection to the real movement pattern for the athlete is lower, so it's more difficult to correct technique, rowing technique. For immediate feedback and rowing, this is actually our invention. In 1999 we start using that virtual reality goggles. In 2010 with John Evans from Active Tools, we developed this monitor, which was quite good. Unfortunately, you know, technology is developing very quickly, and now you can find probably something better things, but some parts were discontinued. But anyway, I think it was quite effective tool. Now a little bit funny things, classification of rowing technology people. Just working many years with, you know, in this area, I found there's two sorts of people. I'm not talking about dummies, of course. First of all, I need to explain the classification made on two factors. First of all, knowledge in rowing science. I would emphasize not in rowing, but in rowing science, because we all know what's rowing. Most of the people know that what is the board, what is the oars. Here I'm talking about understanding of all that mechanics and basically the laws, rules of rowing by mechanics. And then the second factor, knowledge and technology. And the two sorts of people, one and myself, actually, including myself, coming from this area. So basically, we know what we need to measure, what the most important variables closely related to performance And other group of people, we call it techies, they have very good knowledge in technology and they know how to measure. They know a lot of, you know, modern gadgets and gizmos, and I found very often people from, say, aviation, space technology, they come into the room and they believe it's very simple thing. So basically, you just, of course, probably we are much simpler than, say, even airplane or space missile, but anyway, a specific area you need to know. You don't have to underestimate this knowledge, and the learning curve should be essential for both technology people and for sports science people, and also respect to knowledge of in other areas. And now, very briefly, about the history of our developments, because for many years I'm working in this area, and as I said, I came from rowing science, but also I have I was lucky, I have ability, you know, to create something new device to measure. For example, this is history of development of oarlocks, instrumented oarlocks. And first thing was made in 1987, just 1 year after I finished my active rowing. Very heavy, massive two rings, two sensors. Then in 88, actually, I was working in Sports Institute that time, so we have to, like, we have to patent things because it was like a report. It's good point to our work, you know, to apply for invention for a patent. So this is actually was referenced by pitch system. It's not similar, but it was referenced in the pitch patent. This four rings system and a rotating pin. And actually here I tried to measure vertical angle of the oar as well. So there's two potentiometers here. One measure horizontal angle of the oarlock. Another one with some little arm. We tried to measure vertical angle, but it was not very practical. And then this system was reproduced in Australia, and then I think Weber system has similar design through our collaboration with Milan in 2001. Then the next version was original pin, fixed pin. Here you have to replace the whole system with pin. Here this sits on the original pin, and this binocular shape load cell. And then finally, 2011, I've developed this rotating cylinder load cell, which is basically was the basis of NK Empower oarlocks made in 2014. So you see it's quite long history, and basically this is fifth generation of design, but finally I hope that's the most, the simplest and the most efficient one we found. Similarly, we tried to design better and better handle force sensors, starting with simple strain gauges glued directly to the oar shaft. Then in Australia I found this proximity sensor was already used, so we made this removable sensor with without amplifier, then with amplifier, and then finally wireless 8D sensor, which can measure basically two forces. It can be used in canoeing as well, because there's input for second force from the another blade. In canoeing they have two blades. And then it also measure 3D rotation and acceleration of the oar. also quite a bit of history in stretcher force development. Again, the first version in 87, single load cell in the middle, adjustable angle, then two load cells on the tube and slider at the bottom, which idea was to measure only horizontal force. That's important because when you start from, you know, from the general picture and you know exactly that we need only horizontal force on the stretcher, not just force, normal force perpendicular to the footboard, because this is a component of the whole equation of the movement of the board, of only horizontal force. Then it was converted into a 2D version inside the tube. It measures horizontal and vertical force. Not very practical, but it worked. And then this one mounted on the grid, then simplified here, this one 2D, then 1D. And recently we made for Charlie for Oxford Brookes University this 4-point system for ergometer, and now we're working on the conversion in 2D stretcher force. And other developments were or angle sensors. You see, we always try to measure two-dimensional movement of the oar with two potentiometers. And then seat and trunk position sensor, vertical seat force sensor.
Both of us.
And this one, mobile rowing tank. Recently, Radley College built quite similar, quite interesting design. Wind speed, velocity, and this angle guide. Also, we try to develop some electronics, not myself, but I work with electronic engineers. They made it BioRow tail system for the complete set of measurements, simplest system for the ergometer. And recently we made NKO locks working with this system. But this is like a work in progress now. Concluding, I think we live after the third industrial revolution, and we can see the boom in technologies and ability. So ability to handle information is very important, critical now for success. And we can see that gadgets and gizmos are getting more and more accessible, practical, cheaper, easier to use. And everyone, even this mobile phone, it's a lot of technology in it. And basically, you know, with some apps, you can use it as on any board to give you some information. But I think it's important to remember that technology is not always play a positive role in our culture, practical habits, and rowing technique as well. We know very well that all that communicators designed to improve communication, but if you analyze how much you talk to each other and to your kids, I think it's less and less because they all in that gadgets and social networks. Is it real? This is real communication, I don't know. But definitely the world is changing. But when we're talking about rowing technique, I think it's the most, it's very important to choose the most valid and informative variables to measure and give them correct interpretation, reliably related to rowing performance. Not just to measure something you believe is good, but to look at the whole picture, to see how your measurements fit, because you can't measure everything anyway. There's, you know, rowing is in fact is quite complicated thing. Yeah, but we really need to find the most informative and to measure them in the correct way. And if you do that, we can really improve performance. And I think this would be all. Thanks a lot for your attention. I hope I was not too boring for you. You can find more information always, on our website, BioRow.com. Every month I try to create a new piece of, you know, knowledge, information, publish this newsletter. Also, you can see a lot of information in my book, Biomechanics and Rowing. And thanks for your attention again.